heard and saw this. One small step for man becomes this, a major motion picture event the world is waiting for. Ryan Gosling as Neil Armstrong. We'll take you behind the scenes of the movie. Directed by Damien Chazelle, sure to be an Academy Award nominee. We will take you behind the scenes of the movie from the first step on the moon to the first step on the red carpet and everything in between on this edition of Extra Butter. We talk about movies just the way you talk about movies. We are in the California Aerospace Museum. Check it out. Mike is talking to me from the moon. Mike, are you okay?
I am.
What's it like up there?
It's amazing. We're winning. We're winning.
Why did the audio sound a lot clearer when they actually went to the moon? What's up, Mike?
Hey, how you doing?
It's the legendary Mikey Winfield joining us today to talk about this movie and to talk about space stuff.
Yes,
you cool with that?
Absolutely, we should.
All right, okay, let's do it. Hey,
Kelly Smith. Yeah. Now the gang's all together. We got Mike back from the moon.
You got here really fast.
Yeah,
I'm proud of you.
I travel quickly.
I like that.
Yes.
So we're doing a half-hour special on First Man. It's going to be inundated with Academy Award nominations at least, so I think it warrants the show. What do you think?
Of course, and Ryan Gosling, he deserves an hour show.
Absolutely. If it doesn't increase your lust for Ryan Gosling, maybe your lust for all things aerospace. That's why we're at the California Aerospace Museum. Mikey Winfield, tell me one thing about one thing in this place.
Let me tell you, that's the Titan IV blaster for our mission to Saturn.
Wow. That's how you got here so fast.
Yeah, who's excited?
All coming together.
Who's excited?
All right, Kelly, can you tell me one thing in this? Like that spacesuit. What's that spacesuit from?
Oh, that's actually from my closet. No, that's actually a replica of Buzz Aldrin from Apollo 11, who's in the movie.
Which is what we're talking about today.
Look at that.
All right, so let's get right to it. You couldn't talk about this movie without talking about Neil Armstrong.
Yeah,
the guy playing Neil Armstrong, is Ryan Gosling. His lovely wife is played by?
Claire Foy.
So Claire Foy we know from?
The Queen.
Yes.
That show that ran on for many, many seasons.
Love the BBC.
Good work in that. And also The Girl in the Spider's Web, which is a great movie coming out. So she's really taking it up a notch in her career.
That's the girl with the dragon tattoo. This is the latest in that franchise. So she's crushing it otherwise.
She is.
Does a great job in this. Were you shocked to find out that she has the most amazing Midwestern accent anyone's ever had in a movie?
Yes.
It's always a surprise. I mean, we know these people are talented, but when they pull out another aspect of their talent, it's impressive.
That's kind of where I started with it. Take a look.
There are now three space exploration movies that are in my top 10 favorite movies of all time. So thank you for bringing it.
Is this one of them?
Yeah.
I noticed you didn't mention that. Yeah. Don't tell me, actually. I don't want to. It's fine. Let's just.
Right. What if I went, you know, Apollo 13, got down to Armageddon, still no First Man? No, this is it, for crying out loud.
Armageddon.
Don't be silly. Talk about one giant leap. You playing a Midwesterner.
I know.
How was that?
A huge leap. Thousands and thousands of miles. It was amazing. It is tricky because I think when you, for me anyway, I sort of know the west and the east coast of America, and then the whole the middle bit is just I don't know where I sit. And so it was amazing. It was amazing learning about that period of time as well, particularly in Midwest and the, you know, people's morals and the way they lived their life and their attitude, and that really summed a lot of Jan up actually.
Armstrong had said many times that there were so many things, almost a computer couldn't calculate how many things were going through his mind at the moment he said one small step. What was going through your mind when you laid down that line for the first time?
Don't mess it up. You know, it was obviously there's a lot of pressure on that line. It's one of the most famous things ever said. And it's also, I think, really indicative of what I learned about Neil. You know, he had this extraordinary ability to see things in their larger context. He could see a giant leap in one small step, and by all accounts it's something he didn't give much thought to saying until he was focused on landing, and then he thought, I'll figure out what to say. And then he also said, what was I going to say about taking a small step off a ladder, you know? And then that's what comes out. It's such a special thing to say, and a very special person would say that. So there was a lot of pressure on it, but I tried to take a page out of Neil's playbook and not think too much about it.
Yeah, you can tell he shifted. He got very serious when talking about that. You can tell that moment in the movie mattered, because really, that is the moment. That's the crux of the whole movie.
That's a huge moment.
Whoa, did you know that Neil screwed that line up?
Neil Armstrong said it wrong?
Yeah, he said it wrong. It was supposed to be, this is a small step for a man.
Oh, and he said small step for man.
For man, right.
And when you think about it, small step, one giant leap for mankind, it's kind of redundant,
too. Hello, people.
In the meantime, as geeked out as I am to be around here, and once again, here's some California aerospace trivia.
What's that?
Oh, that's a ramjet. That's
right. Wait, isn't it an SR-71?
Look at that.
Somebody's been paying attention.
Yep.
Much like I paid attention to every single word that Bill Berry said to me.
You interviewed Bill Berry?
I saw Bill Berry.
No way.
Bill Berry.
Wow.
Wait.
Wow.
Who is Bill Berry?
Bill Berry is the head archivist for NASA. He knows more there is to know about NASA and the history of NASA than any other human being on the planet.
Good to know.
So did they get this movie right or wrong?
They got it right.
Let's go to Bill for that.
I'm now one of the few people who have probably seen this movie three times.
Oh, you're better than me.
I loved this movie. Talk about its strengths, where you're watching it going, yeah, they got that right. They got that right.
What I found was really intense. Right? I mean, it really gave you that feel for the intensity of what was going on, how, you know, the risks that were involved, mm-hmm. And the emotional level that went high. But it was also really intimate. I mean, all the close-up shots of people's faces. And they really, I think, did an amazing job, particularly Ryan and Claire, at evoking the emotions that people like that normally didn't speak about.
So I don't want to name names, but there are some movies in the past that probably didn't get it technically right.
Yeah.
Are there technical aspects of this movie where you said that is a remarkable reproduction of both the era's technology and what was really going down?
I had the good fortune of going down to the set when they were filming, and I was stunned by the quality of the reproduction of the space capsules. And you'll see this in the movie because there's lots of shots inside the spacecraft.
Right.
And they spent, I'm not sure how much effort they spent on it, but it was, those things, they could have carried those things out of the Smithsonian, and I knew that they were mock-ups that they had made just for the movie.
You've probably seen more raw footage of Neil Armstrong than any other human being on the planet. What points do you think Ryan really lifted of his character?
We actually got to meet the cast and talk to them about the background about NASA and things. And that was one of the things that we cooperated with the production team on. And when I met Ryan, I actually said to him, you know, I don't know how you're going to do this because I don't, good thing you're an actor and I'm not, because Neil is so closed and was not real expressive. How are you going to put that on the screen? He nailed it.
Yes, I was a little geeked out. Stop mocking me. Stop making fun of me. I was talking to the guy.
Who'd you enjoy talking to more, Ryan or Bill Berry?
Well, we were at the Kennedy Space Center. I'm at Cape Canaveral where the rocket really launched. I thought, well, if ever you're talking to the right guy at the right time in the right place, it's that guy. So I was fascinated with that guy.
Timing.
Well, anytime you want to send me to interview Ryan instead, I volunteer as tribute.
Wherever the interview might be?
Like on the moon, I'll go.
All right. You know, it takes a village to put people on the moon, including the astronauts. Coming up in a moment, I sit down with the other astronauts in the story. Patrick Fugit
from Almost Famous?
Yes, you know him from Almost Famous. And Lucas Haas, you know from?
Ooh, Harrison Ford's Witness. Isn't he? He's the kid that doesn't talk.
He is a little Amish kid, yeah. We talked to him about something un-Amishy, NASA, next. And welcome back. We are live at the California Aerospace Museum for our half-hour special on First Man.
Yes.
All right, so Neil Armstrong was the guy, but he's surrounded by a lot of other astronauts, which means Ryan Gosling got surrounded by a lot of great, talented other actors.
Of course.
A couple which we kind of dusted off. So Lucas Haas, we know once again from?
Witness with Harrison Ford.
That's right. Now, don't you think it's interesting that a kid who launched his career, no pun, in an Amish movie, is now playing a guy going to space?
Yeah, that's a bit of a stretch.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's.
I like it though. You can always change your career, you know.
I mean, just to go from Amish to in space, though, that's like worlds of difference.
But that would be, oh my gosh, Mike, write this down. You got to develop this. This would be a great movie. The first Amish man on space.
Oh man, that's
coming. There you go.
The very first barn raising. Instead of drinking Tang on their way up there, they drink a lot of, what do Amish do? Lemonade? Is it lemonade? Yeah.
Natural.
Yeah, what's lemonade.
Natural? Yeah.
Right, exactly. In the very first manned wooden spacecraft. All right, I digress.
I enjoyed it.
I'd watch. Yeah, maybe a half hour, though, not a full
really,
hour.
Really? I'd
a half
say like
movie.
10 minutes, but I enjoyed your story.
It's a great sketch.
Maybe it's better series, maybe three episodes. All right, moving on. Okay. All right, so the other guy, Patrick Fugit, we know from
Almost Famous.
Yes,
right.
Both of them started out relatively young in their careers and now playing two of the most important people in space history. I had a chance to talk to him about it. Take a look.
You two, despite your youth, have had a storied, awesome career, but this has to be a topper.
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely. Definitely one of those moments where you're like, I'm a lucky guy.
I mean, not about just getting called up, but also doing the movie, but then the movie turning out amazing, and then look at where we're talking about the movie right now, for crying out loud.
I felt the same way. You know, this is exactly where we were on the last day of filming. So, like, when I said goodbye to everybody, it was right here. Our trailers were all right here, so it was cool at that point too. You're like making a film
right
in the shadow of the VAB. I mean, it's just a pretty insane experience.
It's so wild kicking it with those two guys because they're so modern as they should be, but they play historical straight out of 1960s.
And that's what's crazy is people think it's such a myth nowadays. You just think of it like, oh, he went to the moon. It seems like not a big deal. But
right.
back then, these people could have lost their lives. And many people did leading up to that. So it's just crazy to think about when you really think about it. And this movie showcases all of that.
You know what? And there's some scenes in the movie that really portray the dynamic with him and his family in the film to, you know, him possibly not coming back. It's great.
That's the tear drip.
At the heart of this film is the family. So coming up in a moment, I sit down with the daughter of one of the greatest astronauts that ever walked the planet or the moon and the people who brought you the story. Next. Hey, welcome back to Extra Butter, doing it from the California Airspace Museum and learning a lot about air and space. We're dedicating a half hour to First Man because it is on the way to winning or at least being nominated to some Oscars, right?
Oh, yes. For sure.
All right, so you guys, when you talk about adapting something that is so full of facts, such important facts, translating that into a movie made for broad audiences, what do you think the hardest thing would be, Mike?
You know what? Incorporating the romance in the heart of real life into a film. I think that would be difficult because the facts are there. We're going to get the facts. How do you get the heart?
So I sat down with Josh Singer. We know him from other movies like...
The Post,
yes,
Spotlight,
yes,
pretty
yes.
much any Oscar contender.
And The Post specifically, very fact-laden. So this is a guy who knows how to lay down the facts.
Indeed he does. And that is such a challenge. I don't know how he does that, but he always nails it.
He does it by starting with a book. James wrote that. We talked to both. Take a look.
I guess it all starts with you. Well, maybe it started with someone touching down on the moon, and then you wrote a book about it.
Yeah, well, you know, in the late 90s, I had done about 20 years of work in aerospace history by that point, and I wanted to do a biography of an astronaut, and Armstrong was the one that I wanted. No one had, you know, I knew he was very private. I knew there was no biography or autobiography, and so I thought somehow somebody's going to have to get to him because we can't lose his story.
And then you, as a screenwriter, I mean, your job, you'd like to think at the end of the day, neither the family nor the guy that wrote the book wants to kick you in the shin.
I did that a couple of times.
Did you correct him a couple times?
He did. He did. Thank goodness for those kicks.
But I think you're obviously, I've read the book and you're so true to it, yet you adapt it well.
You know, it's one of those things. We had a very high bar. You know, Neil sets a pretty high bar. I've said it before, you know, the most terrifying audience for me when you're doing a historical picture is the audience of your primaries. You know, I couldn't sit still while Mark and Rick were watching the movie. And the fact that they have come out, you know, that they seem to be fans, that Jim seems to be a fan, that's more meaningful than almost anything else.
So I sat down with Olivia Hamilton.
Okay.
Olivia Hamilton plays Ed White's wife in this movie.
Okay.
Next to her in this interview, I'm sitting down with Bonnie White, who is the real-life, non-acting, true person, the daughter of Ed White in real life.
Got it. Okay.
So essentially, I'm sitting down next to mom and daughter. There's another layer of complication on top of this.
What?
One of them is married to the director of this movie.
Whoa.
Just roll it.
Your mom looks so youthful.
What is
her secret?
I know. That's like, I know, but tell everybody, well, Olivia's my mom.
Yeah.
So.
What kind of pressure is this? Because, you know.
It was a lot of pressure.
I know. But the fact that she went to so much lengths and trouble to get it right meant a lot to me. And that was how I felt really about everybody, but certainly Olivia, for sure.
You've had an amazing career already, but I mean, how awesome is this?
This is by far the coolest movie I've gotten to be a part of. I think just the importance of the story in and of itself. You feel like you're doing more than usual. You know, the purpose and the honor that you have is just greater.
Right.
And yeah, like you said, the pressure is on. You're portraying not just a real person, but an American hero. You know, I view the wives as heroes just as much as that as the astronaut husbands were.
You brought show and tell. We got to
Yes, we do have. This is my dad and his iconic first American to walk in space. So
Ever.
This photo is, you know, one of the best ones. And then this, which portrays what goes on. There's Jan Armstrong holding my mom's hand. And Susan Borman, all of them were over, and my brother and myself sitting there watching as my dad got launched into space.
Can you go back there in your mind? Can you remember?
I mean, that's
exactly
what Olivia and I were talking about, and I was like, I was kind of little, and I look kind of scared.
You're
I know
scared.
I look scared. My mom looks real scared. I mean, we all it was scary, you know. But I don't think I certainly as a kid had any concept. I'm sure my mom was terrified.
Whoa!
What's the deal with the pictures? She just whips pictures out?
That's pretty cool. Wow.
No, like, I was her first interview, and she walked up with a folder, and she said, I brought these, and people haven't seen them. Do you think you would enjoy it? And, like, you know, Bill, the guy I talked about earlier, the NASA guy, he's like, what? You got pictures? So that was the first time, at least that one photo of her family, it's the first time that has ever been published anywhere within this show.
That's huge.
And you got it?
Yeah.
Good
and then,
job.
It was like 2 minutes later, Bill was over there, like, they were logging them all into the NASA archives. So that was kind of cool, right?
That is so cool. I would love to pick all of their brains and look at all the photos and the videos. I'd like to see the making of this movie. Let's meet with Damien Chazelle and do that next time.
Speaking about the making of this movie. All right, Mike, you're the president of Universal Pictures.
Finally.
Great, good job.
Congratulations. I've had so much. It has been a joy, Mike, watching your career ascend so quickly.
Right.
Congratulations.
From the moon to here.
All right, so a guy walks into your office and said, hey, Mr. Universal Pictures president, I got an idea for you. Let's make a movie about Neil Armstrong and the first step on the moon, and let's have the guy from La La Land direct it.
Oh, yeah.
What would you say?
You know what? That's brand new. I'm open to the idea.
Oh.
Well, I didn't think you were going to be as accepting.
Wait a minute.
Absolutely not. It's the wrong genre. That's what they said.
No, wait. See, that's why you'd make a good president, because you're open-minded.
I'm open-minded.
I think they probably had to drop on the real president, but also keep in mind he's the guy that brought you Whiplash.
That's true.
And then he'd go, oh, that makes sense.
Okay.
That's
you,
true.
However, probably would have greenlight it.
No, I wouldn't necessarily greenlight it. I'm open to the idea of the discussion.
They'd have to convince you. I see.
You're the nicest studio president I've ever met, Mr. Mike E. Winfield.
I think Damien Chazelle blew this out of the water, though, because I was skeptical, to be honest, when I heard that he was the one at the helm of this movie. I was thinking, there's no way that this is going to be that good. And it blew me away, because they film it documentary style, too, you guys. So it feels like you're in there with the astronauts, and no one really makes movies like that anymore. So he killed it.
Well, you really took that tease and ran with it. So I guess my point is, Damien Chazelle coming up next. Don't move. And welcome back to Extra Butter, doing our half hour special, about to wrap it up as we broadcast from the California Aerospace Museum in honor of First Man.
Yes.
All right, I'm gonna go ahead and lay it out there. I am the old guy at the table, because I am the only one that can say, I remember when we first touched the moon.
You're not old, you're just older than us. But you're not old.
Wow.
He was on the moon. He was in the rocket waving.
There is more dye in my beard and hair right now than there is jet fuel in anything that has launched us into space, I promise you. So I had an extraordinary experience. People I could kind of relate to that lived this experience. I remember being a little kid. I remember my mom waking me up, dragging me out to a TV that had a screen about that big to look at these very ghostly images of someone supposedly landing on the moon.
That is so cool.
So I got a chance to sit down with Neil Armstrong's sons, who had the same experience, only their mom said, that's dad.
That would be insane.
Take a look.
The heart of this movie, I believe, is your family. So what was the family going through at that moment? What did you have, fear at that moment or excitement?
It wasn't fear. I had no concern about you know, anything that went wrong, they'd figure it out and come back. And that was partly, I think, I was old enough to know what was going on, but not really old enough to understand all the complexity and the risk about what was going on. So
it's
kind of in that nice sweet spot of, you know, ignorance is bliss, but yeah, I get what's going on. So that worked out well for me.
I was six, so I even more so didn't understand the risk, but I was excited. That was my general tone. I was just excited. I thought it was a great
thing.
Made
a touchdown.
It's how it was all the time. Awesome. Yeah.
So Rick's the older one, Mark's the younger one. Now, Mark was about six, I was about four, but I still remember, but he remembers vividly what that was like. That has to be crazy.
So crazy, yeah.
All right, Mr. President of Universal Pictures, Mikey Winfield. Why did you pick Damien Chazelle to direct this movie?
Why did I pick him? Because I wanted to do things different this time. I wanted to go against the grain.
Right, here we go.
I wanted to start something brand new, so when they hand me the award,
right,
and I give the speech, I can tell them for this very reason I took this type of risk.
I think the president sends other people to pick up the
award. No, I'm picking up the
award.
He's
getting it. He's getting it himself.
The president is picking up the award this year.
And accepting the award, screw all of you other people, the president of Universal.
I greenlit this.
I want to see that happen. That should happen this year. In the meantime, I sat down with Damien to ask him where he keeps his Oscar. Take a look.
I bet I could almost answer this question. Things that you learned on La La Land that adapted well for this film, and things that you learned on Whiplash that directly identified in this film.
Yeah, well, I mean, for sure. I mean, in many ways, the movies talk about similar things. The subject matters might be totally different, but they all, to me at least, talk about what it means to pursue a dream, how hard that pursuit can be, the sacrifices you sometimes have to make in the name of some goal, whether it's being a good drummer in Whiplash or landing on the moon here. And so I wanted to try to approach it in the same way, really from a personal angle, really looking to who Neil was as a person, the toll this whole thing took on him and his family, him and Janet as a couple, their marriage, and how it soldiered through this ordeal. I think that was really what inspired me.
And so, you know, knock on wood, thinking Academy Awards, where do you keep the old one? Where will you put the new one?
No idea about the new one, if that ever happens. The old one is in a on a drawer in a spare bedroom. It's, you know, kind of tucked away. I don't want to see it too often.
Mark my words, Oscar night, that guy is going to be one of the hardcore contenders. I don't know if he's going to win or not, but he definitely make a show.
Highly recommend it.
Mikey Winfield, when you're not walking on the moon, we can find you doing comedy all over the world. And where do we track you down on social media?
Go to MikeWinfield.com. A lot of new dates just added.
All right.
When you're not being the president of Universal. Too.
And when she can get a timeshare on the moon, she and her fiance will definitely be making a show there. And where do we find you?
We will definitely be there for sure. Kelly Savannah Deaton.
Complain to me and you trollers make fun of what I'm about to do right here at TV Marcus
Out.
Ready to see me try to moonwalk for the first time since 1983?
Yep. Dun, 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 dun,
oh,
dun,
I ran
dun,
out of cable.
I think you ran out of steam, not cable, but it was still good.
Oh, yeah.
Woo!
All right.
Anybody?